Welcome back to another episode of Podward State. My name is Sam Brungo.
I'm Grace Cunningham.
On this episode, we had a conversation with Penn State Trustee. What should we refer to him as? Former Penn State quarterback, former Penn State coach, current Penn State Trustee. Nice guy. Jay Paterno is his name. Did someone just say that? Say his name. We had Jay Paterno on.
Can make the viewers guess.
Yeah.
We blur out the face.
Comment who you think it's going to be.
Yeah. Pause the video now.
Pause it now and go to the comments. But anyways, joining me on that conversation was Will Pegler and Connor Krause. Jay was very generous with his time. We were here for about an hour of that conversation. So we're going to push. Sorry, guys, you're going to have to just like read the news like for this week, but we're going to push our headlines and our sports to next week's episode, which is also a very fun episode. We're not going to tell you who the guest is, but there's actually multiple and it's like really exciting.
Mm-hmm. It's like really exciting.
Yeah. Like some very awesome guests.
Yeah.
We're going to jump into our conversation with Jay Paterno, skip our headlines, skip our sports, and we'll catch you on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
See ya.
See ya.
All right, joining us now, we have a former Penn State quarterback, 17 years coaching Penn State, currently on the Board of Trustees, Jay Paterno. Jay, welcome to Podward State. How are you?
Good. How about you guys?
Good. It's good to see you.
Good being here.
Yeah, it's been a while. So just to start off, jumping right into it, growing up in State College, obviously, because your dad was the coach, what do you remember about State College growing up, and what would you say are the biggest changes, physical and non-physical, happened since, how long have you been here?
Oh, my God. I moved back. I left in 90 and came back 95, so it's been, I don't know, it's too late to do math at this point.
Did you grow up in the house right off campus?
Yeah, three blocks from campus. So growing up, it was great because I rode my bike to campus, rode my bike downtown, was around a lot of things. Obviously, physically, the town's gotten bigger. It's gotten a lot more high rises just in the last 7-8 years. I mean, the number of high rises have gone up. But it was a great experience growing up here because it was like, and it's still that way. The majority of people in this town are always going to be 18 to 22 years old. And when you guys hit 22, we kick you out and bring in an 18-year-old to replace you. And so it's always got that youthful vibe. A lot of it has changed. I know I think the Mifflin streak is coming up this weekend. But, I mean, that was one of many things. It used to be a thing called the Phi Psi 500, which was about a mile course, and you went into six different bars and chugged a beer in each one. That was and there was no open container law then, so there were 20,000 people downtown watching the race. And, you know, as a kid, you know, you'd go out and you're 15 years old, and you're watching people run around and total mayhem. So a lot wilder town back then than it is now.
Yeah, it's a little more pulled together, I feel like.
Oh, if you ever want to look up YouTube, there's a Phi Psi 500.
That sounds awesome. That sounds so fun.
That is fun. Yeah.
I don't know if I would
run. Well, it was like there
were
serious runners in the morning, and then you had costumes, so it turned into like a parade.
Got it.
And it was not exactly family friendly.
Did you ever do it?
No, they actually got rid of it right before I got to school.
About Mifflin Street?
I would not have. No, did not do the Mifflin Street. Nobody wanted to see that, believe me.
So kind of outside of just, you know, growing up and being a kid in State College, growing up here, obviously your dad was such a prolific figure. I guess kind of this is a big question, but what was it like growing up with your dad being Joe Paterno? But also, like, I guess was there a moment or, like, do you remember kind of realizing, like, what kind of, I don't know how to put this, like, what kind of weight he carried here at Penn State? You know what I mean?
Well, you know, growing up, it's hard to really say what it was like growing up because I have nothing to compare it to.
Right.
It's the only family life I had. But, you know, when I was in kindergarten, one of my kindergarten best friends knew my dad's name was Joe and had something to do with football, and he thought my dad was Joe Namath. So he was a little disappointed when he met my dad. I don't know. There wasn't really a moment where you went, you know, oh, this is a big deal kind of thing. or that, you know, he's a football coach or whatever. But even when we were younger, he would say, look, just because I happen to coach a team that wins some games doesn't make you any better or worse than anybody else. So they kept it really in perspective, and they kept us really out of, like, we were never, you see coaches now, and the wives are on TV, and the kids are around. Like, he kept us all out of it, and he wanted us to kind of grow up on our own, and it really helped in that regard.
So this is kind of a two-part question. What was it like playing for your dad as a quarterback here, and how did he kind of separate being a father to you and being a coach at the same time?
The first day we had practice, I'm a freshman on a scout team, and I just absolutely lit up. I mean, my helmet's messed up, you know, the whole nine yards, and I get up, and I can hear him laughing. And every time I'd get wiped out, he would just smile and laugh, because I think it was just, you know, there were guys on the team that would have liked to have tackled my dad, and he wasn't there, so I was the next best alternative. So I took a lot of cheap shots. But, you know, it toughened me up and made me a better competitor. But I think the thing is, from the time we got – from the first day I started, anytime we were in the building, it was coach. So just that verbal cue kind of signified that this is a coach-player relationship. I'm not any different than anybody else. And then when I came back to coach, I would always refer to him as Joe and never called him dad in the building. You know, if I was over at the house having dinner, you know, with my kids and stuff, I'd call him dad. But other than that, it was always Joe. And part of that was to just not just so he and I would understand his professional relationship, but so that the other guys on the coaching staff and the players would understand it was just a professional relationship. Because, you know, you don't want to be. And I tell this to people I know that work with family members. Look, make sure everybody understands that, you know, when the boss is on your case, you dislike him just as much right. as everybody else. Or, you know, those things have to, for people to respect you, you got to have that professional relationship.
Yeah, so kind of along those lines, too, growing up in State College and with Joe being your dad, did you ever think about going to play college football somewhere else?
Thought about it, and then, in fact, I think halfway through, I think it was after my sophomore year, I thought about maybe going to Syracuse because back then everybody thought they had a better communication school. We now know that's not true, and Penn State's Belisario is way, 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 way better and continues to be. But that was one place I thought about transferring to, but other than that, I knew I wanted to be here. But, you know, it was good to leave and coach elsewhere to get that kind of perspective.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but your first year you were on the 86 national championship yep. team. How awesome was that?
You know, it's hard to really explain to people now.
Yep.
That season, you know, you're a redshirt freshman, you're on the scout team, and you're playing against guys that are, you know, going to be, you know, all pros.
Right.
And you're just getting the crap beat out of you every day. But you knew you were part of something special because that team had gone 11-1 the year before. There were about 9 or 10 fifth-year seniors that all came back. Some of them could have gone pro because they wanted to win it all. And then it's hard to really get people to understand how big that week in Arizona was when we played them. Because, you know, at that time there was no college football playoff. There was no BCS. Miami could have gone and played Nebraska in the Orange Bowl or Oklahoma, whatever it was. And instead they opted to play us. And NBC came in. And NBC doubled the payout for the game. They moved the game from January 1st to January 2nd. And there was a show back then called Miami Vice, which was the biggest show on TV. They preempted it. I mean, it just took on this huge life of its own. And that game got a 25-0 rating, which is still the highest rated college football game in history. The second highest was USC-Texas in 05, which was 21-7. So it's still a huge game. Like right now, the BCS or the whatever the college football playoff game is getting a 16 or a 15. So by comparison, it was a cultural event because the second was a Friday night, and everybody kind of had that day off. So it really created like this 4-day weekend. So, you know, one of my biggest complaints with the college football playoff now is they play on a Monday night.
At 9 p.m.
It's not like a Super Bowl where you know people have a party all day for Super Bowl. People have work the next day. They've worked that day, so they really haven't kind of found that right spot. But that game was so big. And I've never been in all my years coaching, I was never on a pregame warm-up where there was just this unbelievable animosity. I mean, just hatred, because the Miami guys had said a lot of stuff about our guys during the week. They were saying stuff on the field pregame, and the intensity was just through the roof. And it turned out to be, I know they replayed it, I think it was 2 years ago.
And
my brother's friends, or my son's friends are all texting like, oh my God, everybody in this game would have been ejected by the second quarter. Because, I mean, it was helmet to helmet. It was, you know, lead with the head. I mean, it was just a different game back then, but just a brutal game.
I was going to, yeah, I remember watching, that was like the first time I had seen, I sat down and watched with my dad. He went here as well. And we watched the, it was like during COVID in like May. So it was fun. Yeah. It was a very exciting game to watch.
Different game back then.
Like five picks, right?
I mean, just the hitting.
Yeah.
It was like, don't leave with the head. It was like, you do leave with the head.
Yeah. That is crazy.
Yeah.
So I'm going to follow up on that really quick. You kind of mentioned the hatred for Miami internally. I know there's a Big Ten Network documentary that kind of makes you guys out to be the iconic fashion blue and white, blue collar. And then Miami, obviously they came out in their camo suits, I think, off the plane.
Yeah.
How did you guys deal with that whole look? And how did Joe kind of channel that into the program?
He kept telling us, he said, look, here's the thing. He goes, Miami was convinced they were the greatest team of all time. And they were, I think, 7 or 8 point favorites, whatever it was. And they were going to, in their mind, they were going to come in on a mission and kill us. I mean, it wasn't enough just to beat us. They had to embarrass us. And Joe kept saying, look, I'm going to just tell everybody how great they are, talk about how terrible we are. I'm going to continue to build them up. And they're going to be pressing to not just win the game. So he kept us all very, very even keeled. And it was let them talk, let them do their thing. That's not what we do. Just let's be what we are. And you could tell the pressure was just ratcheting up on them. And they had a steak fry for both teams, like one of the first nights we were there. And the Miami guys all stormed out and said, you know, the Japanese didn't sit down with the Americans before they bombed Pearl Harbor. And the guys showed the stage and left. And so John Bruno is our punter. He goes, correct me if I'm wrong, but we won that war, didn't we? And everybody cheered. And so that became a story. So everybody in Phoenix, that area, just they were rooting for us because they hated them. And so it got to the point where we'd go out to eat and, you know, a bunch of players would go eat and people would say, the owner would come up and say, look, you guys aren't paying. Just beat Miami. Like, we hate those guys. So it really became this kind of, you know.
Culture.
Yeah, just we were the good guys. They were the bad guys.
That's awesome. So you mentioned you came here for the communications school, but directly after your college football playing days, you entered the coaching ranks like your dad. So what kind of led to your decision to being a coach right after school?
Well, by the time I got to my junior, I decided I was a poli sci major, social science, that kind of, so I was all over the place. Like a lot of kids, you just like, oh, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do that. And you're like, I took this class. So, but I knew I wanted to coach all along. That was really what I wanted to do. And so I had a chance to go to the University of Virginia as a grad assistant coach, and the way it timed out, they had a grad assistant opening when I was finishing up. So it just that made the most sense to do it at that time and go. I had a fifth year if I wanted it, but I didn't. You know, it wasn't like I was going to be starting or getting a big NIL deal or anything like that. So I went and started coaching the University of Virginia, and as luck would have it, that's where I met my wife. So it was the right call. Maybe not for her, but for me, it was all right. It worked out all right.
And you liked Virginia, right? So much you named the kid after it?
Well, that's where we met. So we named our fifth child daughter Virginia. And,
oh, that's nice.
Which is my idea, by the way. And my wife's like, oh, my God, I can't believe you came up with that. I'm like, you know, I'm not a total.
It's a good name.
Yeah.
It's better than Connecticut or James Madison.
Yeah. Thank God I wasn't coaching in Michigan back then. That would have been bad. But, you know, it was a great school. I had a great experience. You know, I coached for George Welsh, who's in the College Football Hall of Fame, and really learned a lot. And it was great to leave and see some other things.
Well, yeah, just kind of going off of that last point you just made. Obviously, UVA, we talked about before we started recording, you made a stop at UConn, too, James Madison also. So kind of what were those experiences like, and kind of how was it for you to kind of like see other coaching? Like, you grew up knowing your dad's style, you played for him and then immediately coached for him. So what was it like to kind of see other coaching styles, I guess, and be around other programs?
Well, I think it's important to even for guys that are somewhere, you know, even when I was here for a lot of years, I would still go and visit other schools and look at what they were doing and get a feel for what they were doing. Because I think the minute you stop doing that is when you stop really getting better as a coach. And so going to Virginia was great. You know, the staff I was on, there were three or four guys that wanted to become head coaches elsewhere. Connecticut back then was still in what is now FCS. It was 1AA back then, as was JMU. So there were playoffs and overtime before overtime was at the major college level. So when I came back and overtime came in, I was the expert in the room because I'd been through overtime. But, you know, those experiences were great because you got to understand that every place is unique. And when I came back, I realized these are the strengths Penn State has. This is their differential. These are the strengths this school has. And you had to, especially in recruiting, you have to know what your differential is. So it was good to see those other places and get a feel for that.
So coaching after those places, you came back to Penn State, coached with your dad. You mentioned a little bit in the first couple questions about how you guys balanced that relationship. What was it like coaching under him, and how do you think that you as a coach like were shaped by him?
Well, I think the big thing is he was big on attention to detail. I mean, he was, you know, he knew, you know, his thing was you have to constantly be preparing for games. You got to go in there ready to go. I mean, even, you know, you look at guys now in college football, their head coaches that, you know, they're not, well, I need an analytics guy to tell me when to take timeouts. We need an analytics guy for this. You need an analytics guy for that. And Joe was an analytics in his mind. He didn't need a computer. He knew when the timeouts, he knew when this was coming, knew when that was coming, because every time he watched a game, he coached it. He could be watching the Cowboys and what are the Commanders now, whatever they are now, in a preseason game, and he would be saying, you got to get time out here, you got to do this, you got to do that. And when I would watch games as a kid, it was the same way. He'd say, you know, need to take a time out here, need to do this here, they should be thinking this, or, you know, those kind of things. So he was one of those guys that was very detail-oriented, and that really, really worked its way into the way we were. And in terms of practice time, if we practiced more efficiently than just about anybody, because we everything was scripted. When we walk out in the practice, it would be 7 minutes for this and 12 minutes for that, and you had to know that, you know, in the third period of practice, we're doing 12 minutes of run work, and the first play is going to be in the right hash. It's going to be second and five, and what are we working on? And those things were all scripted. And to this day, I still have 10, 11 years of scripted practices on my computer hard drive that, you know, just I can't erase it just because it's, you know, I'll go back and look at it every once in a while and laugh.
So 17 years, like I mentioned, did you have, and obviously Joe coached pretty late into his life. Yeah. What was he, 84 when he?
Let's see, 84, almost 85. Yeah.
Which is like pretty old for a coach to be coaching still. Yeah. Did you have any aspirations of kind of stepping into that role after he was retired?
Well, along the way, I had some chances to go. You know, there were some people that reached out and said, would you leave? And I kept saying, but then we got to a certain point, I was like, you know, I don't want to leave before he retires. Now, whatever happens, happens. But I didn't want to be somewhere else, you know, watching on TV the last time he coached. But, you know, so I knew I was going to stay here through then. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is that summer he had decided this is my last year. Mm-hmm. And there was a succession place in plan. There were five guys that all of them would be names you'd know, and I'm not going to tell you because he didn't want that. You know, it's not fair to those guys, but there were five established head coaches that he had talked to that were interested in the transition plan was going to involve one of those guys getting the job, and five or six of us on the staff would have stayed with the next head coach. So that was all planned before all the stuff that happened in November of 11. So there was a transition plan. He knew it was his last year, but he didn't want to do a farewell tour or anything like that. That's not to criticize anybody that does that, but he just wanted to walk off the field in Pasadena or wherever it was going to be and say, okay, I'm done.
So, and we'll get into this a little bit later, but when, like you mentioned, November 2011, all that happened, was there any, you might not be allowed to say this or might not want to, but was there any thought of those five coaches that were already in the succession plan being indoctrinated into the new position?
One of them called and said to my dad, what's going on? He said, Joe, what's going on? Who's running the show? And Joe said, I don't know. And he said, well, that's all I need to hear, because he didn't know. Another one of them they interviewed and was going to take the job, and he asked, they said, he said, I want Joe at the press conference to introduce me. And they said, no way. And he said, forget it. So two of those five were definitely interested in taking the job, but because of the politics of what was going on, he didn't understand it was going to be a difficult situation.
So the succession plan that you mentioned, was the administration was in on that.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Okay. Graham Spanier was involved with that. He knew who the guys were. He talked to some of them. Tim Curley was aware. It wasn't a big secret with those guys that they knew this was going to happen.
Right. Do you have, in those 17 years, or even as a player, a favorite story of coaching with him? Something that will always remind
that's
you?
That's hard to, it'd be hard to narrow it down, but I think the 400th win, and you probably remember that game, but
nice snowy game.
Yeah, the 400th win was one that, the funny story is, the week before we beat Michigan, and it's 399, and I knew that, and Guido D'Elia, who was running, Guido D'Elia, who's the guy that created the whiteout, he's the guy that created that entire environment. He told me, he said, look, next week, he said, you might want, make sure your family's in for the game because, if we win, beat Northwestern, they're going to do something after the game on the field. So I said to my mom, Mom, is my sister Diane lives outside of Philly. I said, she's coming up next week for the game. And she goes, why would she do that? And I said, well, if we win, it'll be Joe's 400th win. She goes, oh, is that a big deal? I said, well, Mom, it's never been done at this level, so yeah, it's kind of a big deal. She goes, I don't know. You talk to her. So I call my sister's at the house. I pull her over, and I said, hey, are you coming up next week? And she said, why? And I told her, and she said, look, you're going to want to be here. And she goes, well, are we going to win? I go, oh, it's Northwestern. Come on, we'll kill them. I said, guarantee we'll win. She goes, well, you better, because I'm not going to turn this into a road show every week. I don't go out there. I think it was the next week we were playing Ohio State or something like that. Mm-hmm. So Northwestern scores with 52 seconds to go in the first half. They're up 21-0. And I'm like, oh, my God, my sister is going to kill me. And so they kick. And we were moving the ball. We just weren't scoring. I think we hit two missed field goals or something like that. So we get the ball back, and we get a penalty on the kickoff return, and we are at our own 8-yard line with 47 seconds to go in the half. And, people, oh, that's taking the – I said to Bill Kenny on the headset, I said, ask Joe if we're going to run a draw here. If we get a first down, we're going to go into a two-minute drill, see if he's okay with that. And so Bill goes down and says, Jay and the guys went upstairs. We want to run the draw. If we get a first down, get the two-minute drill. And Joe looks at me and goes, sure, why not? Everything else they've done this half has worked. And he laughs. So we come out, we run the draw, and then we go 92 yards in 45 seconds and score, and we scored the next four times. But just that comment to this day, I still think of it. I go, that's just typical of him. It wasn't mean. It was just, you guys are geniuses.
Yeah, so we all grew up Penn State football fans, and those spread HD offenses in the mid-2000s were kind of the first. That's kind of what made me fall in love with Penn State football. So what was it like coaching that much speed during that time when Penn State was kind of a pounding ground team with Derek Williams, Michael Robinson, and Darrell Clark?
I think the biggest thing that people don't realize is when we were doing the spread stuff, we could get you into two backs and run power plays and downhill run game, and then we're using the same personnel spread out. Part of it was, I think the biggest thing is we had really intelligent football players. Guys like Deion Butler and Derek Williams and Jordan Norwood and even our offensive line, Wisniewski, I think, was a two-time academic All-American. Gerald Cadog was an academic All-American. Those guys were all – Shipley was really smart. So we
friend of the show.
Pardon?
Friend of the show, A.T. Shipley.
Great dude. Okay. But, we had guys that were not only talented but really smart. So we could move people around. If you look at most offenses now, they're using two or three personnel groups the whole year. We had 15, 16 personnel groups, anywhere from five wideouts to three tight ends, two backs, and we could move people around. We could take Derek Williams and Tony Hunt in the backfield and make Tony the fullback and Derek the tailback pitching the ball, and Tony would go block. And so it was a lot of fun. You were only limited by the things you could imagine, because you could come in halftime and say, hey, to Deion Butler, hey, we're going to move you to slot. We're going to put Jordan out at the split end and get you matched up with this guy. And you know what you're doing. Yeah. And one of the things we did when those guys all came in as freshmen in 05, this is back when you had memory sticks for Madden and PlayStations. So we had one of our grad assistants put our entire playbook on a memory stick. And we gave it to them so because we knew they played Madden all the time. And I said, well, if they're going to do it, they may as well use our terminology so they understand the terminology. So these guys would play all the time That's Madden, cool. Using our stuff. And we even had the PlayStation, the quarterback room, and I would go in there and I'd call defenses. You know, if once I played, I'd do defense because I'd want to show the quarterbacks, hey, you can't, this blitz comes, you got to throw here now. So we were doing this stuff long before people needed computer labs and all these simulators stuff. We were doing a lot of stuff, and they were learning the offense. And then the New York Times got wind of it. They came in and did an article on it. Because at that time, NASCAR drivers were now taking EA Sports NASCAR because the tracks were so realistic that they were getting younger drivers familiar with the tracks. So this was this whole – we were way ahead of the game in that.
Did you guys play NCAA football, like as Penn State, or did you guys play Madden?
You had to use Madden because the NCAA game at that time, you couldn't use a different playbook. So we had to use Madden, so which is probably good because now we'd probably – I'd probably be in court, you know, with the players wanting royalties and licenses because we did use them to coach.
That's so interesting.
It was a lot of fun. It was great.
Sounds like fun.
I still have the memory stick really cool from one story. Of the PlayStations that, you know, I can pull it out every once in a while and play with the 05 and 08 offenses.
That's really cool. How much from year to year did the playbook change, or with him was it pretty steady?
Well, the terminology stayed the same. So, you know, certain pass protections were always going to be certain. You know, red protection was always going to be that, and red 40 and all that kind of stuff, the different protections. But you would add, you know, you would add plays all the time. I mean, it was, you know, you'd come in and say, hey, I can run this play out of an empty set. We can run this play with no backs. We can run it with two backs. So it was just a constant, you know, you had your general concepts, but then you would just build things off of it. So you could run, you know, you could run curl flat combination on one side and say, you know, instead of running curl flat both sides, we put a corner in behind. So now I got a two deep side, three deep side, crossing routes. I mean, it was just all kinds of stuff like that. And, you know, you'd go to a pro practice or, you know, I'd call guys. Jim Caldwell was coaching. I forget where he was at the time, but I'd call him and say, what do you guys see? He was at the Colts with Manning. You know, what do you like? And we'd put in stuff from them. So, you know, there was a lot of exchange of ideas and stuff.
But yeah. So kind of just have you made or did you end up making any attempts to kind of get back into coaching since?
Yeah. You know, I got a couple things happened. I had some conversations with people and generally it was the perception is, you know, if we hire you, there's going to be a lot of questions at the first press conference about all this stuff. And our AD doesn't want to deal with that. So, you know, there was a definitely, you know, I wouldn't say blacklisted, but there was a real hesitance by people. So, you know, if somebody called tomorrow and said, you want to get back in it, I'd go. I'd do it in a heart. I'd do it in a second. But, you know, I've done TV stuff. I'm doing some other stuff for that. And so, you know, I'm still around the game, still in it. I'm still looking at tape every week. And I'm still looking at guys and going, I can't believe these guys that make all this money or don't know when to do this. And that's not anybody in particular, so don't read into that. But, you know, I'm watching games and still coaching them, and, hey, they should be doing this, doing that, that kind of thing.
So you were, like, this past season, you were watching every game this year, kind of, like, you felt, you with Penn State, I mean, you felt like
I mean,
you were.
I mean, like Greg Schiano at Rutgers, I coach with, know him really well. I watched them. You know, Urban Meyer I knew well, and when he was – at Ohio State, I could root for them all but one week. it's like, I know you, I'm friends with you, but, you know, I just can't. I can't do it, man. It's Penn State. I went out to watch them do spring practice and went down to Texas to watch them do spring practice. Nice. So I still know a lot of guys around Matt Rule.
Sure.
In fact, he was just in town last week to get an award from the College of Liberal Arts. I talked to him. So, I mean, I stay around it.
Very cool.
I remember there was a rumor, because my family's Pittsburgh, and that there was a rumor in 14 before Narduzzi was hired that your name was being thrown around. Is that real? Or is that
No. No.
those Pitt people would have.
No question. And, I've known Pat since he was an assistant at Michigan State. And really, you know, I know Penn Staters don't like him. I like him. He's a great guy. He really is, and he's good for Pitt and done a nice job there. And, you know, as much as it kills me to say that Kenny Pickett had a great year, and, I mean, you got to love the kid. And you kind of hope that that six-year magic, you know, translates here next year. I mean, the funny thing is, I'm reading all, you know, you get career this, career that. I'm like, of course he's played. He started for 5 years. I mean, you know, the first big game experience that Kenny Pickett had, I think, was in 17 against Miami. They were 10-0. And since that, you know, that was the big, they were the big turnover chain guys, whatever, and he beat them. And since then, Miami was basically a 500 team. I mean, that just flipped that whole program back into the dark ages. Right. But, I mean, you know, he was one of those guys that, you know, luckily they missed that field goal that, you know, clanked that one off, because had they made that and gotten the ball back, that, you know, who knows how that game ends. Mm-hmm. I kind of wish we'd play him. Narduzzi's he's a good coach, really good football coach.
Where's he from? He seems like
Youngstown.
Such a Yinzer. Okay.
Youngstown. When he was at Michigan State, he's still playing the same style of defense. And right. I was down watching the Steelers, OTAs or whatever they call them now, and Pitt was out there working out. And I went over and we were talking. And I said, you know, I still got to remind you every time I see you is that, you know, the 5 years you were at Michigan State, we averaged 35 points a game against your ass. And he goes, yeah, I know, but we did beat you once, whatever it was. But really, you know, those are the kind of friendships that you get when you're out recruiting and you're running to guys all the time. And the recruiting's changed so much, everybody's on planes all the time, and you're not really spending a lot of time in high schools where you're running into other coaches. So it's a different thing now, so I don't think these guys know each other quite as much.
So, I don't want to harp on this part of the story as much, but in 2011, when, you know, everything happened and Joe was removed and all that stuff, obviously there was in the media and everyone outside, I feel like, of State College had their perception and were down on Penn State and all this stuff. How do you feel like the State College community and the Penn State community rallied around you guys and your kids who were in public school? And just how do you feel like the almost internal of like our little small town reacted to all this?
What one of the things that amazed me is just sticking to the State College community was on social media and things. There are people I went to high school with that I wasn't particularly close with, but and had no idea that this all meant as much. And these people came out of the woodwork and were just defending Penn State, defending Joe, and just going after people. I'm like, oh my God, I never knew she felt that way about Penn State, or that he felt that way about Penn State, and whatever. And you know, there was a girl I had this crush on for like 3 years of high school, and she's like, "Oh yeah, I always wanted to marry." I'm like, "Oh well, now you tell me that." But you know, I'm happily married, whatever. But I'm like, you know, these things that come out, I'm like, I'm glad it took this. You know, I'm laughing like, "Oh my God, you never even looked twice at me when I was in high school," which I don't blame her. I wasn't a particularly handsome dude back in high school back then. I kind of had the Lloyd Christmas Dumb and Dumber haircut back then. I'm not kidding, and you know, it's taken me many years to admit that. Many years of therapy that you look like Lloyd Christmas. People really rallied around that. I think, you know, the thing that was disappointing about the whole thing was the administration of Penn State in those first couple days, the Board of Trustees, as it related to that, and then over the next several months and years, to this day, really hasn't defended Penn State. I mean, they really have not come out and said the overwhelming majority of things involved in this did not happen on Penn State campus, were not related to Penn State's campus, and never really have defended this university. And then I think, you know, that's one of the things that really bothered me. Never really defended Joe, because at the end of the day, he followed the policy exactly what he was supposed to do. And to this day, they still train people at this university, say, this is what you do. And I laugh when I see their policy. I go, yeah, that's what one guy did, and you fired him for it. So anyway, but the community was great. And yeah. Penn Staters were great all over the place. It was, you know, just people bought into a media narrative.
Mm-hmm. How does, like, I just remember all over ESPN and everything, it was so negative, and a lot of it just having the Paterno name. Like, how did you guys deal with that, and how much do you deal with that to this day, 10 years later?
Not as much now. I think time has kind of, you know, changed that a little bit. But back then, you know, the reality is what again, and part of it is because Penn State reacted the way they did. Now, you guys are all in communications, and so that story broke on a Friday afternoon. Okay, the first time anybody from Penn State went in front of a television camera to address it was the following Wednesday night, and on that night they fired the president, fired the head football coach. So in those 5 days of void, everything just went rampant. And in those 5 days, then you come out and you fire two guys, you're basically telling the world, we think they did something wrong. So it all compounded. There are, and I know, because I've guest lectured at USC, I've guest lectured at UMass, I've guest lectured at Pitt, among a bunch of other places, about how poorly it was handled. This is case study for people of how the media reaction and crisis management was botched at Penn State. And then as such, it set a narrative in motion. When you realize in a 3-year grand jury investigation, and I'll just talk about my dad because I know this part of the case the best, he was in the grand jury for 7 minutes in 3 years because he was only told about one thing. He reported like he was supposed to, and that was it. That was his, and from a legal standpoint, that was his entire involvement in this case. However, as this case exploded, he became almost a central figure. You know, he was fired on a Wednesday. That Saturday night on Saturday Night Live on their, you know, the weekend update, they did a skit where they mentioned Joe's name 6 times. They mentioned Penn State 4 times. And they didn't mention Jerry Sandusky 1 time. So he became even more of a central figure in this thing. But by and large, most people that know anything about it understand that, you know, that it was, the narrative was not accurate. But, you know, I'll tell you one story. My daughter was playing an indoor field hockey tournament. It would have been 2015, 2016. And the team she was on, they had their names on the back of the jerseys. So my wife was in a small town in Pennsylvania watching this game, and the people behind him go, oh, Paterno, I know that name. And the woman says, oh, yeah, that's the coach that raped all those kids. And my wife turns around, and she normally would never say anything, and she turned around and just bit this woman's head off. But, I mean, that's a perception that people had, which obviously is inaccurate.
This is kind of just my last follow-up before we move on from this on to more current stuff. But do you feel like the, like, famousness of the names involved like took away from like what really happened? And how do you think Joe felt about the fact that his name was overshadowing what actually happened?
Well, two things. I think there's no question it overshadowed it. And I think that's unfortunate because the perception was that this had to have happened because there was a big cover up. And we tried to make things, at the end of the day, there was no cover up. I mean, nobody was convicted of cover-up or conspiracy or anything. If, you know, the three guys that pled for failure to report, but there was no, and the prosecutors in the case flat out said there was no cover-up. I mean, they said, you know, Joe was in no way involved in anything illegal. In fact, the prosecutors in the case commended Joe for the way he handled it. So that kind of overshadowed the thing. And one of the things that we kept telling people is, if you believe this can only happen in a town in this kind of situation, you're missing the point. This is going on in every town in America. And it's the guy down the street, or it's somebody else down the street, or it's a teacher, you know. And by trying to make this as though these things have to happen in a setting like this, you know, it kind of took away from that. I think my dad, he went to the hospital about 7-8 days before he died, and one of the last things he wrote on the pad was, maybe the silver lining is that this, something good can come of this. There'll be more awareness of these issues and things. So we pushed to try and, you know, my mom paid to develop a training program that all the state-owned universities like Clarion, like Lock Haven, those guys, she paid, and that they created a program to train everybody at those places. So we kind of took that as a way to try and create something positive out of it as best you can. But, you know, the president of Michigan State at that time was very critical of the way we handled it. A number of other presidents were very critical. And, you know, lo and behold, the Michigan State president's tearing us one. And on her campus, she is Larry Nassar. So, you know, when we were telling him that, look, this is going on everywhere. And One of the things is we issued a report basically saying these are the things you should be looking for, which in that report, which was done by an FBI profiler, he flat out described exactly what Larry Nassar was doing. And she refused, I don't need to read anything, whatever. And then lo and behold, you know, that was going on their campus. Not that we take any joy in saying we told you so. I mean, it was tragic. But, you know, because people were not, it was too easy to just point at us and say we're horrible human beings.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that it was pretty frustrating that the Board of Trustees never backed Penn State and how the crimes didn't happen on Penn State's campus for the majority, and they never openly supported Joe. So what made you want to run for the Board of Trustees and now a position you've been in for 5 years?
Well, I thought it'd be fun. I thought it'd be kind of fun. No. I think the thing was is I ran for the Board of Trustees because I believed I could do some good here. And I've tried, you know, I've seen Penn State go from a place that was relationship central to almost transactional in some ways. And I wanted to try and get that back. And, you know, we have fought really, really hard to try and make sure that this, we don't forget that first and foremost, I mean, look, Penn State's a giant operation. We're a $7.8 billion entity when you add in Penn State Health and the medical school and all that kind of stuff and research. But at the end of the day, the only reason we exist is because we're here to educate students. And I have never voted for a tuition increase. Will not. I don't care what they say. You know, we can find that money somewhere else. You know, we don't need to pay 52 administrators, you know, 700 grand, whatever, you know, all these salaries and things. You know, we should be finding ways to cut rather than have students have to come up with more money because, you know, everybody talks about affordability. You know, we're past affordability. But we got to try and find a way to hold the line. You know, Purdue has not raised tuition, I think, in 10 years now. And their enrollment continues to go up, and they've done some things really, really well out there. So we're looking for other people like that. But I felt like, you know, I wanted to get the Board of Trustees and have a real impact on this university, and I've been able to. And so that part of it's been, you know, satisfying.
So obviously, like you were mentioning, there's a lot of positive things that you guys are working on, but one of the things that people have been critical of for you specifically on the Board of Trustees is when you voted against the Lash renovations and kind of infamously said, my former boss used to say football is here to serve the university, not the other way around. Yep. What went into that decision, and how did you deal with, like, the backlash, sort of?
Well, I didn't really deal with the backlash because I knew I was right. And the reality is this is, when that vote happened, I said a couple things. Number one, we're in the middle of COVID and we were furloughing employees and people were taking pay cuts, and I didn't feel like it was the time to borrow $48 million. Normally, when you do a building like that, you raise a bunch of money. We hadn't raised anything. So we were borrowing $48.5 million. Essentially, the weight room went from 20 weight stations to 24 and added a piece of indoor turf that they could work on when 15 feet across the street, you know, across the sidewalk, is the largest enclosed indoor turf anywhere on the planet. So it seemed like at the time it was not the right thing to do in terms of borrowing the money. In light of COVID, we didn't know what we're going to be able to get in terms of revenue, TV, you know, for tickets that fall, which as it turned out, we got nothing. And I said, on top of all that, the facilities arms race is over. Name, image, and likeness is coming. And people say it's never going to come. I said, I'm telling you guys, I know what the hell I'm talking about. I know this industry. Name, image, and likeness is going to be the ball game. It's whether you have a 10,000 square foot weight room or a 12,000 square foot weight room is not going to matter. No one cares when you look at what's happened to USC with all these the weight room has nothing to do with it. It's cash. And I knew that was coming, and I told people that, and they thought I was out of my mind. So, no, I have no problem with that vote. And when people would ask me about it, I'd say, look, I voted, you know, and there have been people that have accused me of keeping money from the football program because of that vote. They got the money. They're building the weight room. And now you're hearing from the coaching staff, we need name, image, and likeness money. I go, yeah, if only somebody had mentioned that 2 years ago, we'd be further down the road. And to the point where one of the projects that I got involved with this year was creating a collective with Anthony Lebrano and a guy named Ben Bohm and a guy named Kerry Small. We put together the Success with Honor Collective, and some other guys had some of the money to do it. So we really put that together and put together the advisory board and everything. So I not only said it was coming, I essentially put my money where my mouth was.
So yeah, you talked about you came to Mike Poorman's Com 170 class. So you came and talked to us a little bit about NIL a couple weeks ago. But yeah, like you said, the success with Honor Collective, kind of what's that been like so far? And I know, I mean, NIL is such a beast of a thing, topic to tackle. Like there's issues that come with it. There's positives that come with it. What's it been like so far, kind of getting involved in that and seeing what it's like?
Well, now that we've kind of set it out there,
yep.
Because I'm a trustee, there are rules. I can't write checks.
Got it.
Which that doesn't bother me.
Yeah.
Plus, I'm running my own collective. I've got three kids playing college across, and they're not doing any work for me. So I'm running a collective with those three kids. So I can't arrange deals. You know, I can't come in and say I want, you know, this person to work with this athlete or whatever. So, or I want these donors to give money towards these things. But the thing we set in place was we wanted this to be, at the end of the day, you have to have a differential. What's your differential when you recruit? What's your differential as a collective? And our differential was going to be, we were going to be here to work with all 31 sports. We didn't just become an ATM machine for recruiting. Because, and I'll tell you, you know, that model is not sustainable.
Yep.
The ATM machine model is not sustainable. And I can get into that in a second, but we wanted to create internships for student athletes. We wanted to create educational opportunities for student athletes. You know, they had a autograph sign this past weekend where a number of athletes got paid to do that stuff. So we were able to create a lot of things for student athletes. So it's gone pretty well so far. We have a lot more work to do. And I think there's a lot of positive momentum and people feel like, okay, this is something I can believe in because this isn't just about giving some high school kid 50 grand to come. And when you get to the ATM machine type model, so say you're a big donor and we go to you and say, hey, there's a 5-star quarterback in Pittsburgh, pick a town. And we say to you, we need 75 grand to get him. Okay, great. So he comes in here for 75 grand. That's probably light for what's, you know, but anyway, let's say 75 grand. Now, a year later, you say, well, you know, your biggest value as a player is when you're getting recruited and in the transfer portal.
Right.
So I'm going to go in the transfer portal and see what I can get in the open market. Now I go back to you as a donor and say, look, we need 100 grand to keep him. And you're like, well, I just gave you 75 grand to get him. Now I got to give you another 100 grand. Oh, and by the way, while we got you on the phone, there's a 5-star running back in Philly that we need 50 grand to get. And there's a wideout in the transfer portal that we got to get for 50 grand. That guy is going to go, okay, enough. Like, how much do I? So I think this year it's a big deal. Mm-hmm. I think as you go, when you start having to stack recruiting classes, then you start asking people for 4 times as much money as you do. I think that'll all kind of come to a crashing halt. Plus, there's this thing called return on investment. And if you look at what's going on now, I mean, you're not seeing national deals for college football players. Even a guy like Stroud at Ohio State or the guy, the quarterback at Alabama, Young, right?
Bryce Young.
Young. Yeah. You're not seeing them do a big Nike deal.
Right.
Because it doesn't do anything for Nike. So for them to give them that kind of money, it's not moving product. Now, that may change. But last year, you know, Dr. Pepper went out and signed the quarterback at Clemson. He goes out week one, they lose 10-3 to Georgia,
right.
And it's terrible. And that ad vanished. And that's not to disrespect the kid from Clemson. I mean, Georgia's defense is pretty good. But I think people are not going to see the return on investment with it.
So you feel like it's kind of going to like plateau a little bit?
Yeah, I think it'll plateau. It'll settle down. And I think within 3 years we'll have revenue sharing. And this
right.
And the NIL stuff will be a whole nother thing. That'll go by the wayside.
It is. I feel like NIL right now is like the – it's like the Wild West because like nobody, it's exciting and it's like it's new for all these athletes, but it's like nobody knows like what's okay and what's because it's like free agency almost, and that combined with the transfer portal is like nuts. Like even like with Caleb Williams going to USC, like it's crazy. I mean, I can only imagine how much money he's getting. I just saw on Instagram like yesterday he bought the whole team like Beats headphones. Caleb Williams did. Like
he had a guy representing him that was. They were talking 8 figures, and everybody went, come on.
That's crazy.
Dude. Yeah. Dude, NFL guys get that.
Yeah.
You don't. And look, the reality is, you know, if they get somebody to give him eight figures and he gets hurt week one, that money's down the drain. So, you know, like I said, there's no return on the investment.
Right. It's almost like all of the, like, NCAA, like, violations just, like, went away. With,
oh, absolutely. Or,
like, especially with money and, like, the recruiting stuff. Like, I hope that, what's his name? Adam Brenneman got a...
Yeah, Reggie Bush?
Yeah.
Can we give him his Heisman back? Like,
right.
But, I mean, at the end of the day, it was you know, I know people said that about the same thing with Terrell Pryor at Ohio State.
Right, yeah.
It's like, but the rules were what the rules were.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
And they knew that and they violated it. And, you know, I know some of those guys, so I'm the last to throw stones at anybody. But the rules, you know, the things that were under the table are above the table now, above board. And they're all legal, but but you still, at the end of the day, they have to perform a service or work, and you have to be fair market value. So to give a guy $50,000 to do one Instagram post a month, that's not going to pass.
Right.
But no one's going to. The NCAA right now is so afraid of antitrust lawsuits, they're not going to touch it. And I think they know there's a revenue sharing case in the courts now. That based on what Justice Kavanaugh said, you know, and I'm paraphrasing, but he basically said, in no other industry in America would this business model be legal.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. It's over.
Yep.
The minute it gets to the Supreme Court, it's all over, and they're going to have collective bargaining, and they're going to be talking to student athletes. And, you know, and I've said this a bunch of times, just, you know, if you took 30% of the television revenue, and I'm just pulling that number, that's not because I can do the math for it, but you took 30% of the television revenue that Penn State gets in the Big Ten, and you split it up among all 800 athletes, every one of them would get $25,000. And you have to do it that way. You can't say the football guys are going to get 75 and women's volleyball they're going to get 15. You can't do it because of Title IX. And what people don't realize is when you go on the Big Ten Network, football is the number one sport, men's basketball is the number two sport, and women's volleyball is the number three rated sport. And they're now flying to play games on Wednesday nights instead of, you know, Friday, you know, Friday, Saturday games. So they're adjusting their lifestyle and their schedule to create TV content.
Yep.
So you'd have to split it up evenly among all the athletes. And if you went to most athletes and said, you can either deal with the NIL mess or get a check for $25,000, most of them would take the check for $25,000 and say, I'm coming out ahead.
So, yeah, kind of going in a little bit of a different direction with that. You know, obviously, the guy right now at Penn State who's trying to navigate all this NIL stuff for football is James Franklin. Before him was Bill O'Brien. But so what, I guess, right when Bill got here after everything kind of went down, what was your relationship like with him? And even now, what's your relationship like with James Franklin? Kind of a two-part question with both
Well,
of guys.
I've kind of stayed out of everything.
Got
I've
it.
Just kind of stayed away for a couple of reasons. Number one, I don't want to be the old coach that's around.
Yep.
Like, oh, when I was coaching, we did. Yeah, I don't want to be that guy. Never wanted to be that guy. And if I didn't have kids, probably would have moved and just come back in for games. Just could be easier to be away from it. And also, because I have a TV show, there's a media component where now I have to kind of keep things at arm's length. And also as a trustee, one of the things that they have told us and has always been the way is trustees are supposed to stay at arm's length as well. So that there's no conflict of interest and friendships don't come. So I've just stayed away from it. I go to the games, obviously, but I just, you know, they got a job to do. They got better things to do than worry about me. And so I stay away from it and let them do their thing. And, you know, and when I'm at games, people are like, I said, I'm not going to get into what I would have done. Just stop. Just shut up, please. You know, it's hard enough down there without people taking runs at what you do. Now, when I'm on the show, we tape our show every week, then we'll have an opinion and we'll talk about it. But I don't get into it with fans and stuff. And I let them vent positively or negatively and, you know, let them have that moment.
Sure. So I think I kind of, just going off of that note, I think I kind of know your take on this because we talked a little bit about it actually in the Comm 170 class, but how do you feel about, I know you can't get super into it, but how do you feel about James's contract, the one that he signed right before Thanksgiving, and kind of what were your initial thoughts on that?
Well, whether it's James or anybody else, a coach should never get a 10-year contract. That's ridiculous. And for the kind of money that we're guaranteeing, basically we've given up a lot of leverage in terms of, because the contract, because we guaranteed all the money on the contract, it's a massive buyout. Whereas his buyout goes, and it's not just him, this is a lot of other people's contract, to leave, his buyout goes from $5 million to $2 million like that. And $2 million buyout is nothing. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's not even, when Matt Rhule went to Baylor from Temple, they gave him $6 million. And that was a number of years ago. So, I mean, a $2 million buyout doesn't really ensure that we're going to be able to keep him in 2 years without another lengthy contract. But, you know, whether it's Mel Tucker at Michigan State, or whether it's James Franklin at Penn State, whether it's Brian Kelly at LSU or Lincoln Riley, 10 years is ridiculous. And one of the reasons, and I don't blame them for asking for it, I don't blame the agent for asking for it, but one of the reasons they're all asking for 10 years is because they all know what a lot of people know, that revenue sharing could be coming.
Right.
And if revenue sharing comes and we've got to give 20% or 30% of our TV revenue, that's a $20 million check. So you're going to have to cut salaries.
Right.
But if I got a 10-year contract at $8 million a year or $7 million a year, so you can't touch my contract.
Right.
So you're going to have to go find that money somewhere else. And a lot of those agents made these contracts because they want to beat the punch. They want to beat the revenue sharing.
So not necessarily looking at Joe, but if you had to, in one sentence, give the Paterno legacy, what would you say that it is at this point?
Well, I think the reality is it's essentially as an educator. I mean, it's the generations of football players that came out here and learned lessons. I mean, you can run into guys that played from the 60s, 70s, 80s, doesn't matter, and they'll tell you the same kind of stories about attention to detail and don't, you know, pay attention to little things. You know, take care of little things, big things will take care of themselves. Or different lessons. You know, Matt Millen, that thing said, he goes, yeah, the same lessons that I learned from Joe, my sons know. And I think that's been the real legacy, has been, you know, all the people, but not just the guys he coached. What has amazed me over the years is how many people that went to Penn State came and said, I learned this while I was there from your dad. So his ability to reach so many people with, you know, really with a message, you know, life lessons. And I think that's really been the legacy of it. It's not a building. It's not wins. It's those kind of things.
Right. We got a couple questions left here for you. We appreciate you taking all the time.
Oh, no problem. It's a lot. It's been fun.
I lost my train of thought. Oh, so in the documentary, we saw you rocking the Bonnie's shirt. You got you and Kelly, you guys have.
I didn't even realize, you know, they came and I was just wearing that. I'm walking. And so I'm like, oh my God, I'm wearing a St. Bonaventure lacrosse shirt in this thing. I don't know if that's good or bad for St. Bonaventure, but it's in there.
So you guys have five kids, all five, like you mentioned, play lacrosse, three of them currently Division I.
Yeah.
How did lacrosse become such a big thing in your family? And I mean, I played football with Joey when I was little, but what's going on with these lights?
I don't know.
I don't know.
Are they like
I can still see you, so I'm good.
Yeah.
Anyways, Joey obviously didn't pan out with football, but lacrosse is working out for your family.
Yep.
So you can chat a little bit about how you guys transitioned from
the
football
world
to lacrosse.
I mean, it was just something they started playing. And when I was growing up, nobody played lacrosse here.
Right.
No, it wasn't a thing. And it just became something that they did in the spring, and they really liked it. And I think part of it was Joey's playing baseball, and he was okay, you know. But, I mean, you know, he's a pretty good player. And then I think age 9, it was we got a travel team. And the guy said, well, can he pitch? I said, no. He goes, well, he won't make the travel team because everybody has to pitch. I said, why does everybody have to pitch? I said, because we play 7 games in a weekend, and we need the arms. I go, wait, you play how many games in a weekend? Like, these kids are how old? Like, back up. Like, you know. So once he wasn't picked for the travel team, he was looking for something else to play, and it became lacrosse in the spring. And then I think the one practice in football, he took a shot to the head, and he was over a community field, and he was veering to the left, and they're like, where are you going? He's like, I'm walking home. And they're like, no, you're not. And it was Drew Freiberg and some of these other guys, and that was the end of football for him, because he just, you know, just didn't want to deal with the concussions, all that kind of stuff. Well, mostly my wife, you know, it's like, I'm like, it's a concussion, big deal, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, so he started playing, Caroline played, and then all my other kids started playing, and so they're all playing lacrosse, and I still don't know the rules, and I never yell at a ref because I don't know the rules. And I go and I watch the game, and I know if we have more goals than they do, we won. You know, it's that easy.
Beautiful.
The concussions might be Joey's fault. He was wearing 36 playing around like he thought he was Jerome Bettis. So that might have been self-inflicted.
Yeah, he was a little bit of, he wasn't shy with the content.
So one of the last things I wanted to ask you, we it came up a little bit. His Mike Pullman, his Comm 170 class, you come in there every semester and talk. You guys are good buddies. He's a friend of our show. We closed out last season with him and had a really cool episode, told a lot of stories about covering your dad and that kind of thing. Do you have a favorite Mike Pullman story?
Oh, God, I can't remember. I think he when I was 15, I started working in the press box. On game day Saturdays, I got $10, all the hot dogs and Coke I could eat, and I would do stats, I would do stuff like that. So that's where I got to know Mike.
That's cool.
was way, way back. And then when I first went to Virginia, they were doing that preview magazine that they have.
Mm-hmm.
They asked me to write something for him, and he called me. I was at UVA. I wrote something for him, and I think I made $150, which was a big deal. I mean, that was a good chunk of cash. And when you're a grad assistant coach, it's an even bigger chunk of cash because you weren't making any real money at the time. But Mike and I have kept in contact, he and I, over the years. And then he and I actually started working on a book project that is still sitting somewhere. And it was basically a murder mystery set in a college town. And we made up a fictional college and the whole nine yards. And it was a little racy, and you know, it was a lot of fun.
Oh, of course it was racy.
But
it was like, Mike Pullman was
involved. It was like one of those things where, like, you know, I don't think we could ever publish this. But the funny thing was, is there was a, you know, it was written, and we were working on this in like 90, maybe 90, no, it would have been 2000s.
Sure.
But one of the things that, like, I've gone back and looked at that we really nailed was when this murder happens and a coach is found dead. The media that descends, we absolutely nailed what happened here.
Oh, there you go.
And but like
no shit.
With that, you know, just the satellite trucks and CNN and all this kind of stuff. And I, you know, after this all happened, I said, Mike, you got to go back and read this. This is like really interesting. So what we had two different characters. He was his character was a media member. It was all first person. And my character was the quarterback.
Huh.
And so, I think it was quarterback. And so we were trading off chapters. And the quarterback was trying to figure out who the murderer was because it was his junior year. He's going to make the jump, and this is going to screw him up, and he's going to have to stick around for another year. And this media person is, like, local, and if she hits this story, if she hits this story, she goes big, and now she's going to CNN, which is a little bit what happened with Sarah Gam.
Yeah.
And we were writing this before 2011.
Huh.
You know, so we really had it pretty much nailed.
I've never heard him talk about that.
That's so interesting. Yeah. I would like read that book. I think that sounds kind of interesting.
Yeah.
You guys
yeah.
should keep working on it.
Well, here's the thing.
Well, now it might be a little
his
weird
writing style.
Yeah.
His writing style is he edits everything as he goes. I am throw the story down, don't worry about punctuation, get it out of your mind and on the page. And then you go back and you cut this and you add that.
Yeah.
So it was like, you know, I'd write this chapter and then I'd be like, okay, Mike, let's go. Clock's ticking. Let's go. I want to get this next chapter going. And then as it turned out, all this stuff happened. And I ended up writing a book. I wrote one about my dad, but I also wrote one called Hot Seat, which is takes you inside a college football program. It's fictional, but the stories that are in it, most of them are absolutely happened. And were things I saw, things that happened. So I kind of did go with that, and now I'm working on really kind of a sequel to that one because people are like, I got to know what happens to them the next year. So I'm working on that right now. And then once I get that done, I think the agent that I'm going to work with will go to Netflix and people like that and say, hey, you know, what's one on HBO? Ballers.
Oh, yeah, I love Ballers.
This is a college football version of Ballers.
Oh, there you go.
And so now this the sequel will have to deal with NIL and transfer portal because when I wrote the first one, none of that stuff was really a thing yet.
Interesting.
So now it's, you know, the coach is going to be looking at a salary
cap. A lot of new
cap,
content.
Salary
yeah.
cap, so to speak. Like, you know, we've only got X amount of money to give these recruits. So
there you go.
Yeah.
So you've been around Penn State for so long, and I'm sure you have so many answers to this question, but if there's one piece of advice you could give college students, what would that be?
Well, I'd give it to you when you first get here, and I would say, you know, you right now, you're sitting here saying, I've got 4 years, and at 18, 4 years looks like an eternity. And before you know it, it accelerates. you get through that freshman year seems like it never ends, because you're still kind of 1 foot at home and 1 foot here, and you want to get home. And then you get home and you're like, I want to get back to school, because like, I have to, like, someone wants to know where I am. You know, I got to be in the house at a certain time. I got to get back to school. And then you get back to school, and once you get that freshman year, it just goes. And I think the biggest thing is, don't ever pass up opportunities to do things that are different or learn things, because, you know, even now, I mean, even after college, you know, I thought coaching would last forever. You know, I thought, you know, this will never end. This is great. And I think sometimes I didn't take those moments and sit down and go, wow, this is really, you know, I just got to take this and soak this in, because it's always the next thing. And I think having kids your age, I think everything is on hyperspeed with your generation. It's, you know, this should have been done yesterday, and I'm going to do something on social media and get that done. And so many people are so busy posting things while they're doing them, they're not breathing and taking in the fact that they are, in fact, doing that thing at that time. And as a result, things just kind of speed by. And next thing you know, you're taking your last class and you're like, whoa, this is all over. So you really got to enjoy it. In a place like Penn State, there are so many opportunities to do so many unique things. Just, you know, don't be in a rush. Take that time to enjoy that moment. I mean, I think one of the years I really matured in terms of that perspective was in 05, we were coming off of two bad years in 03 and 04. And 5 or 6 weeks into the season, I was like, you know, this, I'm on the practice field, and I finally said, you know, we got something going here. Like, this is phenomenal, what we're going. And I was so focused on the next practice rep, the next game, that I wasn't really enjoying the fact that the journey, you know, was really what the value is. And one of my favorite recruiting stories is we were recruiting Walter Payton's son, Jared, who ended up going to Miami. And we do a home visit, and my dad and I, I'm sitting, Jared Payton and I, and we still communicate, we talk every once in a while. We're sitting there in Walter Payton's house, and there's my dad and Walter Payton, and they're talking to each other, and I'm like, this is
coolest thing
unreal.
Ever.
I mean, this is just unbelievable, one of the great NFL football players of all time. And the thing that both of them were saying at that time was, when you win a championship or graduate or whatever the case may be, it's not the moment. Like, you get to that moment, and you're like, okay, this is great, I got a trophy. It's when you look back years from now, it's the journey. It's the people that you were with. It's, you know, remember that third down and eight, and we had to get this first down, and so-and-so did that. Or in 05, it was, you know, fourth and 15 at Northwestern, and Isaac Smolko tells Robinson in the huddle, I'll be open. And we had hit that all week in practice on long yarded situations. And, you mean, it's those things that you'll remember forever. It's not holding up a trophy. It's not, you know, you get a ring for winning the Big Ten. I don't even know where mine are. You know, not to, but I mean, it's, you know, when I see Mike Robinson, I see guys that from 08, you talk about in the moments, not about necessarily hoisting a trophy. So to me, that would be the best advice I can give you is, you know, soak it in. I mean, do everything you can, but, you know, make sure you soak it in and understand that this does not last forever.
Say what you will about the Paterno legacy, but I think that your family, yourself included, have done a lot for this community and for this university, and I think that that can't be overlooked. But we appreciate you coming on, chatting with us, telling stories, and getting a unique perspective. I think our listeners are going to enjoy this.
Thanks, I appreciate it, guys.
That was our conversation with Jay Paterno. Appreciate him coming on and chatting with us. Is it weird that you can, like, see yourself?
Yeah.
You gotta put on the headphones, then you can hear yourself and see yourself. Nah, it's fine. Now, to get everyone a little involved, except for Shannon, we are going to invite our folks.
I can hear myself.
Who's
sniffling.
First? Who do you want first?
Keely. Joining us now, we have Keelsters. What's
hey,
up,
Grace.
Keelsters?
How are you?
I'm good.
I'm good too.
You seem a little not good.
I'm a little nervous.
It's okay.
Hot seat.
Yeah.
I'm scared.
It's okay.
I'm sweating.
I have a question.
Okay, I'm ready.
If you could only have one, like, sauce or, like, condiment for the rest of your life, what would it be?
This is, like, a hot take. I don't like sauces or condiments at all. Neither does my mom.
What?
But yeah, like I don't like ketchup, anything? Don't like mustard. I don't know if like salad dressing counts. Does that
do you like
count.
Salad dressing?
Yeah.
Like ranch?
Yeah, like that's normal.
Okay.
But I wouldn't be like, I want to put ranch on this
what
if
about
it's
like
anything other than a salad.
Terry Ho's yum yum sauce, like the hibachi sauce.
Oh, wait, that I like that. But like I guess
not like like mustard like, ketchup.
No.
Okay.
No. Interesting.
Jim. Say something nice about one other person in the room.
I really enjoyed reading Will's senior column today. It made me sad, but it was really good.
Yay.
Really well done.
Awesome.
Of course.
Thanks, Keely. Like
see ya.
Our next person in the hot seat is Mara. How are you, Mara?
I'm pretty good.
That's awesome. if people like floated like all the time, like how high off the ground would you want to float?
That's an awesome question. Where did you get that?
I don't know.
I'm pretty scared of heights.
Okay.
So, I don't, like, 10 feet? Like, I don't...
10 feet?
Like, that's pretty, like, high.
I would want to float, like a foot. Like, just, I would just float around, but, like,
wait,
it would be, like, I don't know, like...
Wait, like, you, like, asked that question,
subtle.
And I pictured everybody just, like, birds, like, really, like...
No, I would just want to float, like, a little bit off the ground.
All right, actually, I'm changing it. Say something nice about Connor.
Connor.
Yeah, I'm gonna choose the person.
This is like this is like so stressful. I think I would like not be able to think of anything. Not because Connor, but just because.
Connor, I really like that jacket. Thank you,
Mara. Cool. Thanks, Mara. Joining us now, we have Charlie Pegler. Charlie, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you, Sam and Grace?
I'm doing well. I can't speak for Grace, but
I'm also doing well.
Really?
Yeah.
That's good.
Do you have a question?
Yeah. How many kindergartners do you think that it would take to overtake you?
Like all of them?
In the world?
I don't know. Do I have a weapon?
No, it's just like you have nothing.
Like,
you're like this.
10 to 20.
Like,
are
they
smart
like,
kindergartners?
There's the average kindergartners, like a couple like classes.
I don't know. Probably like 20 to 30 because there's always that like tall one.
Like what do you think the cutoff would be where it was like it was too many?
Like 50. No, 50? Probably less. Probably like 30, yeah.
Will you say something nice about Jordan?
Oh, Jordan, I love you. Your call made me really happy, and I love your voice. It makes me happy, too.
Aw, that was so nice.
Love you, sweetie.
Awesome. Thanks, Charlie.
Thanks, guys.
Joining us now, we have Tegan Staudenmeyer. Tegan, how are you?
I'm good. How are you guys?
I'm good. I can't speak for Grace, but...
I'm still good.
Okay.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Here's our question. Would you rather walk with a rollerblade on your left shoe for the rest of your life or have an angry midget walking in front of you slightly slower than you want to go for the rest of your life?
Okay. No, I'm just kind of imagining like Danny DeVito, but stumpy-er in front of me. And I think, honestly, I would prefer that.
Okay.
I would prefer the rollerblade because I would get good at like rollerblading
on
one
foot. Yeah.
I think I would just constantly roll my ankle.
Yeah, I'm with you there. The
Maybe
height
in
difference
the beginning.
Is kind of weird, the weird thing for me. Maybe if it was like a Heely.
Yeah, I was thinking about a Heely.
Tegan, say something nice about Charlie.
You have quick wit. Aww. You're fast. You're fast with the punches. You got it. Yeah.
I actually had an ex-girlfriend one time that told me that she was like, oh, you're like quick-witted. That means that you have crippling anxiety and like diagnosed me. And I was like, oh.
How does that add up?
Wait, that doesn't make sense. If you have anxiety, you're like, what do I say? Not
it's like
I
you're
know
always
what
thinking of the next thing so that people will make you funny. I don't know.
A step ahead.
Hi, my name's Haley.
Hi, Haley. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good.
If you were like a platypus and like, you know, they sweat milk.
No.
Okay. Well, they do.
Wait, what?
Yeah, platypi. I don't know. Platypi, they sweat milk.
Like cow milk?
I don't know. It's like milk. I'm not really sure. But if you sweat something other than sweat, what would you want to sweat?
Oh.
Like a different liquid.
It's kind of gross. Something clear. So probably like vodka because it's clear.
I think like lemon juice because it would like offset the smell.
Wait, maybe something that would like, yeah, clean me. You
like
know?
Shampoo?
No, not like soap.
Body wash?
Like...
I think milk.
Perfume.
Milk is probably fine because I don't think milk
would
be like
to?
Sweaty, like or sticky once it dries.
I wouldn't want to sweat milk.
Can you say something nice about Tegan?
Tegan, you are really good at doing makeup.
Aw. Queen. So thank you. Thanks, Dots. Now we got Another, Jordan cool. Mansberger. Jordan, how are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. Are you okay?
Yeah.
So our next question that we have is...
If you had a different name, what would you want your name to be?
That's a good one, actually. But did I tell you about why I'm named Jordan?
No, it before? Tell us.
So my dad wanted to name me Dale after Dale Earnhardt.
Oh, wait. That's like really fitting.
Praise yeah. hell. Praise
my,
nah, hell.
Yeah, no. My dad's like the stereotypical redneck. He's going to watch this episode too. But like he wanted to name me Dale. And my mom was like, absolutely not. My mom wanted to name me Ross. And he was like, no, he'll get his ass beat every day. And so then my dad wanted the initials. Well, his name's Bob. So they weren't going to name me Bob Jr. because what the hell kind of name is that? So then he wanted the initials JR in my name so that he could call me Junior, like Dale Jr. So I'm Jordan Ross Mansberger. Not once has he called me Junior.
What's your middle name?
Ross.
I thought it was something with an F.
No, that's Jordan from college, bro.
Oh my god.
I'm you so just stupid. Now got that?
Well, I guess you're it's a C, not an M, so okay.
Ah. Oh wait, yeah. What happens after you graduate?
I'll just be Jordan from
the workforce?
Yeah, Jordan from unemployment line.
Jordan from Pennsylvania.
Jordan from home.
Yeah. Jordan from
Jordan, will you say something nice about Stutz?
I like your shirt.
Okay, thanks. That was like,
what?
That was,
what did you want me to say?
Boring. Say a better one.
No, okay. Say something about like her personality.
I really appreciate all the work that you do for Pod.
Aww. Aww.
Yep.
Aww. Yeah.
For those listeners that don't know how much work Haley does like a very large amount of work. It's a lot. Shout out Haley.
And also Haley's shirt is nice, but that just wasn't a good enough compliment.
Hey, Will.
What's up, guys?
How are you?
Shit.
Yeah, what's
wait,
up?
Why is he doing that?
Holy shit. Good to be back. What's up?
If you had to replace your hair.
I was actually thinking of that before, but
if
I
if you had to replace your hair with a the hair of
hair
a,
on my the hair on my head or like like leg hair. Like, you know what I mean? Because that... What? I'm serious. Okay, well, never mind. Whatever. You asked the question first.
Yeah.
I think that was, like, fair.
No, I'm actually going to be, change
like,
it.
Weird, all right.
Who is your favorite sibling?
Oh, well...
Actually,
no, wait. I'm kidding. I don't know the answer to that. Come on, man.
Mine's probably they're Jack.
They're good guys.
Yeah, I think
they're good guys. Yeah.
I like Jack. Jack's probably my favorite. I mean... I love you guys all, but
yeah.
Anyways,
would you rather have toes for, like you have toe, like your toes are still there, but would you rather also have toes on your hands?
I think.
Wait. Would you rather have toes as hair on your head?
Yeah.
Or as fingers as armpit hair?
Toes, like regular length fingers. So it'd be like,
yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
That's disgusting. I could do something with toes on my head. I just wear a hat.
Do the toes grow?
I think fingers, because then if someone tries to tickle you, you can grab their hands.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, hands, yeah. Right? But I think I would constantly be like uncomfortable. Toes on my head, like
you would never be able to just like be like. Toes.
Yeah, yeah. So toes on my head is the answer.
Toes on my head.
All right. Will you say something nice about Keely?
Sure.
Has anyone said anything nice about you?
I don't think so.
Okay. Will you say something Never. Nice about Keely?
No one's ever said anything nice about Keely.
Yeah, no, I definitely haven't. Yeah, that's true.
Wait,
no, that's
actually,
not about Keely.
Something about Mara.
Oh, what the heck?
Well, because Mara
said
something about Keely or about Connor, and Connor will say something about Keely. Yeah, do about Mara.
Okay. Mara going to Detroit with you was really fun. And I think you have a great three years ahead of you at Onward State, and I'm jealous of you. So,
yeah. Awesome. Thanks, Will.
Yeah.
So, now we have Connor Krause joining us.
Yeah. What?
What's something that's not edible that you wish was edible because it looks like it would taste good?
Candles.
But yeah. Not Tide Pods.
Did I think
like a forbidden fruit?
Yeah. Candles.
Oh. Forbidden snack. No, like...
Like
it's something not like smell like it looks.
I think like oh. Opening like a neon color of paint, like and be like, oh that's like a really good color of, like that's a really good yogurt flavor would be awesome.
Say something nice about Keely.
Keely
Lamb.
I like your shoes a lot. They're pretty cool and colorful. I think you have a good sense in fashion.
Aww. Very nice. Wow, that's so nice.
All right. Well, that was kind of fun. We're going to wrap up now. Introduce the people.
First, we have Haley Stutzman. Editor Haley, Miss Queen. Then we have Jordan, Sound Wizard. Ooh, yeah, Sound Wizard. now we have Tegan. Tegan's drinking a Gatorade, it appears. Not sure what flavor. We have Keely. Keely looks sleepy. I think she's going to go home and get in bed. We have Mara. Mara's been a little bit quiet today. I think she's also sleepy. We have Connor. Here's Will. He's in a really green sweatshirt. It matches Mara's shirt. Here I am. Okay. I don't know what that was. now we have, Charlie. Charlie also looks sleepy. Hi.
This has been another very long episode of Podward State. Appreciate all the guys out here. We're missing Shannon tonight. But
missing Shannon tonight, but
I'll say something nice about it.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Shannon, if you're listening, you are very bubbly and you like to laugh and you'll make everyone else laugh.
I think Shannon is a great
She drives Charlie and Haley around and they listen to country music.
I think that Shannon is a great storyteller, very charismatic, and really brings
She brings the zest.
It's like hard to It's hard. She's good at making people smile. I feel like she would bring up a bad mood. But anyways, from the Willard Building, this has been another episode of Podward State. My name is Sam Brungo.
I'm Grace Cunningham.
We will see you guys next week for our very special,
season
finale.
Tune in.
Take it easy, guys. Be safe.
See ya.